Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Markus Knauer. I'm working for EclipseSource. That's a company, or my office is in Karlsruhe. That's not far away from here, about an hour's drive. And we are developing RAP since now over 10 years. It has its roots in W4T. That was the in-house product that we had before. We open sourced everything. And today, I want to give you a short introduction into RAP, what RAP is, because many people still are asking us, how do I start? What do I need for a simple Hello World application? I will show how to start with such a Hello World application. Then I want to show you a simple demonstration how to migrate the very well-known mail demo to a RAP application, followed by some other exemplary RAP applications that I'm involved with. And then the second half, or the last third of the talk, is about what we did in RAP 3.1 with the last release, together with Oxygen, with Neon, and what we are going to do for Eclipse Neon. Let me first start with the very old picture. RAP is a server-side technology. It's called Remote Application Platform. What we are providing is a windowing toolkit, or widget toolkit, that is programmed against a Java API that's compatible with SWT. And that's the main advantage, because of the fact that everything is SWT compatible, you can replace your already existing applications and move them to the server and move them to a web browser or to a client. On the left-hand side, you have you're writing your application. The application is written against RWT and is running in a servlet container, like every other web application as well. That can be a Tomcat, a Jetty, but also a WebSphere or JBoss server. The communication protocol to the client is based on HTTP. On this HTTP layer, we have defined our own protocol. We'll see this on the next slide, which is based on JSON. And with the help of this protocol, we are keeping the client and the server side in sync. The client itself can be a browser. That's the standard JavaScript client that we are delivering. But we also provide native clients that we programmed for mobile platforms such as Android or iOS. That's what we call Tapris. Let me start on the server side. After 3 days of EclipseCon, this kind of code should be familiar. That's a standard SWT button. You need a parent widget, a parent composite to create this button. It's going to be a push button, and you're setting a property, a text property on that button, push me. So that's the SWT compatible Java API that we are using. On the client, we are rendering this, dependent on the client, into such a button, push me. That's on the client. The protocol, or the messages, are transferred via HTTP and are looking like that. What you can see here is the JSON message that contains a create operation. A create operation for widget number 3, that's W3 here in this case. And every widget has a identifying number here. And this widget is of type RWT widgets button. It has a parent. The parent is W2 in this case. It has a style because it's a push button. It has bounds. That's the size where on the client we are drawing this button. And after all, we set a text property on this button with the name push me. That's behind RAP. We have a couple of those operations, like this create defined. Other operations involve, for instance, events that we are sending, that are sent from the client to the server, and other like delete, remove, and so on. About 7 different operations. This is the RAP protocol. And in the end, there's just a server that's communicating with some front end, some clients. Let's see the first RAP application. I've started a simple, that's an empty project here. The first thing that you need to do is you need to select a RAP target. Usually you can go to the download page. Here somewhere? No, it's not preloaded. To our download page. You see the latest release. And there's a URL that points to a P2 repository. To make it easier in this network, conference network, I have a copy locally with exactly the same details. In this RAP P2 repository, you will find 4 different features. The most important thing, or the most important feature, is the RAP runtime feature that contains all the bundles that are required for simple RAP applications. The SDK feature contains the RAP runtime bundles, but also the source code. That's especially important if you're developing. And the basic Equinox target is a stripped down feature that contains from the Equinox project and from Jetty all the things you need to run a RAP application locally. It contains the Jetty web server, it contains the servlet interfaces, it contains the necessary bundles from OSGI. That's my target definition. And the first thing that I'm creating I'm calling this configuration. I'm creating, I need to provide an application configuration as an OSGI service. This will be picked up, recognized, and this contains all the details that are necessary for registering the servlet that will deliver the RAP content. I have to make this an OSGI service. Give it a name, for instance. Now you see that we've created the component definition for this one. And now I need to provide an entry point. An entry point defines I'm selecting the path of the URL where you can reach this RAP application in the future. And you need to provide an entry point type. That's the class that's going to contain the SWT code and a number of properties. For the first iteration, I'm leaving this empty and use an empty hash map. Now create the ECE entry point. The entry point the easiest way to create your own entry point is to use the abstract entry point that we provide as a superclass. And there we go. We have a method, create contents. From the framework, we create a top-level composite. That's the parent for everything. And we are able to use this to create our first simple application. I defined a new grid layout with two columns. I'm adding a new button, for instance, with style push. Or I can add a second button. Remove all the typos. Then I need a launch configuration. I prepared one in advance because that's faster. I need to define a servlet path. That's the same one that I have in the application configuration, hopefully. I used the same one here. I'm starting in the development mode. We know two different modes. In the development mode, you are able to debug the JavaScript. That's the full JavaScript that we are sending to the client. That's not optimized, so in a production environment, you won't use this one here. And I already selected some bundles. We need the servlet bundles, we need declarative services, we need Jetty and the servlet bundles here from Equinox. We need a servlet container. And after all, we need the most important bundle here, that's the wrap RWT bundle. And if we are running this, we see some log messages here. And if you go back to this page, reload the page, we see the two buttons that we already created. So that was my first application. It's just a Hello World application, very simple and easy. And from that point on, you're in your already familiar SWT world. From RCP to wrap, maybe you remember this little RCP demonstrator here. It's a little RCP mail demo, as it's called. And what I'm going to show are the three or four steps that are required to migrate this RCP application into a wrap application and run it in a browser. So first I'm closing this here. I'm importing this. That's the source code of the mail demo, the RCP one. There are some red markers. The first one is the manifest. I'm looking into the manifest, and I see here it's a require bundle. We provide our own Org Eclipse UI bundle, and we have a different name for that. It's called, in our case, Org Eclipse Wrap UI. And this comes with all dependencies to wrap. That's my first change here. The next change is There's something else red. If I'm looking into this one, there's an action factory about. I'm not really interested here in this demonstration in the about window. That's not available in wrap. I'm removing those lines. Remove everything that's red. Okay, that was my second step. So there were some code changes, just a few little code changes. Next thing, this was an RCP product, which is defined in the plugin XML. Make this a little bit bigger. There's this core runtime products extension point that defines an application with the ID mail application. Just remember this mail application. I don't need this extension anymore. I can delete it in the wrap case. But I need an entry point now. And we have this entry point. Fine with the ID. And here I need to enter the same application ID that used to be in the RCP product. The next part that I need to change is the path, that's the URL path of this application. The same what I did in the application configuration in the other example. Calling this mail demo. All I need to do is now, I need to create a second launch configuration. I prepared one that starts all the bundles in an internal web browser. Can use a fixed port. Maybe this one here. Should be starting very well. And if I'm able to switch between the views here, you should be able to see, or do I need to use this one? Okay. Got the reason. I used a different entry point path in the entry point main demo. Okay, here we go. That's the very same application, the same code, except my two or three changes running in the web browser. Here we go. Of course, that's not always possible. If you have a legacy, a large RCP application, there are many things that can go wrong. For instance, if you are working with singletons, you need to be careful that you provide singletons for specific sessions. That's what we call session singleton. We provide helper classes for that to make that easier, to make the transition easier. But that's another thing that you should be careful of. Other things that could, that have the potential to go wrong is each user session needs a certain amount of memory. In an RCP application, that's not really important. Your laptop or your notebook has lots of memory. But on the server with hundreds of users working on the same server, memory is a factor. But it is possible. Where are my slides here? Okay. Now some exemplary wrap applications. One advantage of using wrap is you can use everything from the Eclipse community, from the whole Eclipse ecosystem. And there are many projects. And then if you combine those things, then you get something that's more than just the sum of the pieces. What I'm doing with one of our customers since many years now, we are using EMF as modeling basic, where we define large article models. And we use wrap to render this, to render editors for these large models. And to automate things, we are using the Eclipse client, EMF client platform, or EMF forms. And the result is that we are able to profit from all those technologies by combining them. And we have very rich form-based editors providing validation, providing help, providing all those features that you know from RCP applications in a web browser. Another project that's hosted at Eclipse, that's Eclipse Dereachable. That's a web IDE, very interesting project run by SAP. And they are using RAP as front-end technology to deliver their editors or their web IDE to the users. Another new version is another interesting project is the DSLForge.org project. They are hosting DSL editors, text editors, where you can type. With all the help, is it still open somewhere? No, sorry, it's not open anymore. Another interesting project, and they are willing to contribute this kind of text editor, which is a component that's still missing, or that was still missing in RAP, this style text editor here. TSM Explorer is another large project that I've seen in the past years. I'm using this video here. What they did, it's a workbench-like application. And they integrated nearly every feature that you can think of, including fancy diagrams and so on. Now let's look back a little bit. The 3.1 release, which we released together with Neon in June this year. It contained a lot of bug fixes. Even after 10 years, we are still able to find here and there a bug fix or a place where we can improve the performance. One thing that is new, and for some, on the back end, a real problem, that's the Java 8 that we require in some of our bundles. We did this for a very good reason. We rely on platform bundles, and our dependencies require now Java 8, so we need to do the same. We support now right-to-left orientation. I'm not sure if someone is writing right-to-left. My guess would be that you all are writing like myself from left to right, but that is an issue in some regions of the world. We are now supporting an alpha channel for colors, and we moved. Maybe you are aware of the RAP incubator project. That's a sub-project of RAP where we are testing new technologies. We are trying to bring them forward and make them stable. And last year, we decided that the rich text editor component, which is based on the CK editor, is now stable enough to be brought to the main RAP core runtime project. That's what we did. And it's now even more, or it's better configurable and updated and a ready-to-run component of RAP runtime core. In the Nebula grid, which we provide our own implementation for, we now support column spans, and we are still working on the E4 compatibility. Our initial plans last year were to migrate the E4 RAP incubator from the incubating status to the main RAP project as well, but in the end we were running out of time. There were legal reasons, there were CQs that we should have filed against the Eclipse Foundation. That was one reason. The other reason was that it's really hard to make all those small changes in the Eclipse E4 platform where they are not multi-user, where they are lacking some multi-user capabilities. Just this week we found circumstances where you can run into a situation where the user interface, UI thread, is locking the event bus in a multi-user environment. Another interesting thing is the client file loader. I'm using this myself in a customer project to load CSS files. And that's a new client service that allows you to dynamically load JavaScript and CSS files at any time. And Rev ensures that those JavaScript or CSS files are really loaded only once. This is important if you're writing your own custom widgets, if the widget set that's provided by Rev is not enough for you. The old JavaScript loader that we had in the past is now marked deprecated. It's still working. It's one of its drawbacks was that you were yourself responsible for keeping track how many times you load something. And that's all now moved to the client file loader, and that makes it much easier. We introduced, or I introduced, a new bundle header. Most of you won't see this bundle header never ever again. It's called, it's a provide capability. I'm trying to use this bundle header for those cases where you have SWT and RWT libraries at the same time in your OSGI runtime. In those cases, you have two bundles providing the same Java packages. And that's a very hard case, because then you need to make sure that the correct bundles are wired in a correct way to the REP and to the SWT bundles. And with this bundle header, that should make it easier to fulfill this dependency. That's part of our E4 preparation, because in those cases we are not only using the same package structure, but also for some bundles the same bundle ID. More details are in the REP E4 incubator in this case. Another smaller thing is that we are now support transformation on the canvas. In the past there were some complaints that REP applications always look like a workbench application or like a REP application, not like a native web page. And in order to overcome this, we are now allowing to make this smoother with this document overflow capability. Usually you can only draw REP widgets on the visible part of your browser window or browser tab. And the scrolling, for instance, in a table or list, is done by REP. And with this new method, it's possible to use larger composites that behave or that have a feeling like a real native HTML web page. So these were the main parts that we invented for REP 3.1. Currently, we are working, or we improved the HTML markup for two additional widgets for the message box. And for the expand item, where we now allow to set HTML markup, another long requested feature was the file type filter for file upload. You now can, or in the past we had compatibility issues with some older browsers, namely Internet Explorer, because they didn't allow us to set a certain MIME type. We have this file upload widget, and you want to tell the browser, please upload files, but only GIFs or only images. And that's now possible with a file upload filter. Another thing that we're still working forward is the compatibility work with E4. We hope we can migrate the incubation part in the next release cycle. And then we are still discussing what makes sense from a user perspective to develop for the next RAP release. We are open for suggestions. There are lots of bugs in Bugzilla feature requests. We are trying to prioritize those, but it's really up to you, up to the user base, to decide what is really the most important thing, and we are always looking for feedback. So the main message is, the plans for the next RAP release are not yet finalized. It's up to you to move forward or to discuss this with us on the mailing list or on the news group. That's about my short intro and overview about RAP 3.1 and the outlook. Thanks for attending. This was the last talk of EclipseCon Europe 2016. Are there any questions?